Good to see everyone back this afternoon. Don't forget to stay for the celebration of birthdays and anniversaries and eating all the healthy food that will be delivered to us. Good times. If I asked you a question this afternoon of name me one book down through the ages that has been attacked more than the Bible, I would be curious to hear what that book is. Because I don't know any of the writings of man that has been attacked more than God's holy writ. Not even close. There's a number of ways that people have tried to denigrate the scriptures, attack them. Some will say, well, the Bible's inspired, that is true, but it's inspired just as the writings of a Homer or Shakespeare or Dickens is inspired. Others will say, yes, it's inspired, but God really revealed his thoughts to man, and then he allowed man to write down his thoughts any way they wanted to. Others will even claim it is inspired, but only partially. The moral, the spiritual writings in the scriptures, those are from God. But when it gets to the miraculous, that's not inspired. Those words are made up. They're basically fables. So I thought it'd be interesting this afternoon to do a study and notice how many individuals at times have tried to destroy the Bible, but also even religious organizations have tried to do that. There are many reasons why we call this book the Bible, that it is inspired, that it is God's holy word. The lack of, let's put it this way, the inerrancy of the scriptures, that you don't find any mistakes that are written in it. That should give people pause. That should make people think. When you think of not just the words that are related to us spiritually, but when you think about all the history that you find in this book, the science, the medicine, the biology, the geography, and not one mistake. I read that when Rand McNally, some of you probably have never heard of Rand McNally, this was back before GPS, but when they first came out with their maps of the United States and all the roads, the first one was chock full of mistakes. So they supposedly got better as time went on. You could say that one more piece of evidence to add to the list that proves the Bible's inspired word of God, it is the enduring quality of the Bible. And what I'm talking about, and that's the title, by the way, it has lasted. It's endurance. It's still with us after all these years. I'd like to begin with the internal evidence, what the Bible itself claims about being inspired. We'll start off with Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 8. This passage will probably sound familiar to us because Peter says a few things along the same kind of lines. But in Isaiah 40, verse 8, we read, the voice said, cry. And he said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all the goodliness thereof is as the flower of the field. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, because the Spirit of the Lord bloweth upon it. Surely the people is grass. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever. Now, Isaiah wrote this approximately 700 years ago. I said approximately. You always put that approximate in there. So it doesn't have to be perfect as far as the dates. And when it comes to dates, as Brother Hatcher mentioned beforehand, we'll get close, hopefully. But a long time ago, let's turn to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning in verse 23, you'll notice the similarities. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God which liveth and abideth forever. For all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away, but the word of the Lord endureth forever. And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. It will always be there. But also, as it states, along with God's word that's going to last and last forever, we'll also notice that those who are faithful to it, true disciples of God's holy word, we will, remaining faithful, live eternally as well, and live eternally in heaven with him. 1 John 2:17. Jesus stated, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. Mark 13:31. We've been talking about this Wednesday night in the Bible class. I'm glad we're studying this subject. It's good to be reminded of this. But we're talking about the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Old Testament. Writings of Moses, who inspired by God to write these things down. And people who know much more than I do states that it was probably written somewhere between 1440 and 1400 BC. These five books written so long ago, they're right in front of us. They're still here. It endureth, and they will continue to endure. Isaiah, written over 2,700 years ago. Words of Christ, around 2,000. Words of Peter, a little less than that. That's a long time, folks. It is still here. After all of those individuals have tried to disparage it, who tried to, in many cases, destroy it, and I mean literally destroy it, burn Bibles, it's still here. I was curious, and I wanted to know, basically, it first started off with, I want to find out how many great sellers stay on the New York Times bestseller list. But I eventually gravitated to which book has been on that bestsellers list more than any other. One book has been on the bestsellers list, New York Times, for 11 and a half years. That's a long time. One brother went on to write that for a book to have perennial success, longevity for like 20 years, that's fairly rare. But then he went on to state, for a book to have perennial success, this kind of longevity for 100 years is very rare. And then he mentioned, for a book to have this kind of success for 1,000, it's minuscule. How long has God's word been around? 3,400, 3,500 years, basically, round figure. In other words, a whole lot longer. It's still here. I also come across this article Maybe this is the providence of God. You never know. You know, when you're on the computer and you're typing up certain things, you will notice that certain things are brought to your attention. But it was an article, and it was talking about 15 of the most influential books of all time. You will never believe which one was number one. The Holy Bible. And it went on to say, it is the most read book in the world. That's today. The most read book. Amazing, isn't it? Or is it? But I think if you are, for example, an atheist, this has to gall you. It really must. But again, think of any other book that has more attempts at it, to destroy it, than the Word of God. You won't find one. So let's look a little bit more at the external evidence of how it's been attacked. Now I'm going to start with one more point that's internal. It's found in the Scriptures, and it's found in Jeremiah chapter 36. There was one of the kings, his name was Jehoiakim. You probably know this story. This was in the time of Jeremiah the prophet. This wasn't very long before Judah was invaded. Let's start in verse 29 of Jeremiah 36. And thou shalt say to Jehoiakim, king of Judah, thus saith the Lord, thou hast burned this roll, saying, why hast thou written therein, saying, the king of Babylon shall certainly come and destroy this land, and shall cause to cease from thence man and beast. Therefore thus saith the Lord of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, he shall have none to sit upon the throne of David, and his dead body shall be cast out in the day to the heat, and in the night to the frost. So he's reading of his own destruction. He doesn't like it. So he's sitting by a fire, and as this is being read to him, he takes a penknife and he takes that roll, what we would call a scroll, and begins to cut it up and to throw it in the fire. Now, of course, that changed everything. None of these things took place, right? No. They did. All of these things took place. In verse 23 actually talks about him burning the roll. That prophecy had been made of Nebuchadnezzar. His forces, and we know his forces, came down from the north and took over Judah and took Jehoiakim's life. Matter of fact, in Jeremiah 22, verse 19, it actually states that he received the burial of an ass. In other words, just like a dead animal is just left to rot, the crows pick at it. That's what happened to Jehoiakim, the king. So burning the roll of God's holy word did not change anything. Actually, God told Jeremiah to have it written again, and it was written again, and even had more added to it. It endureth forever. It reminds me of trying to put a limit on preachers in their sermons. Usually you have some more words added to it. Well, let's get a little bit more to the enduring quality of the Bible, the external evidence. There was a king who reigned between 175 and 164 BC. Most people, unless they have some biblical knowledge, biblical history, have studied this recently, has probably never heard of Antiochus Epiphanes. Most people don't. You get someone off the street and you ask them, have you ever heard of Antiochus Epiphanes? I would say about 98% would say no. And that's in the world. This is during the period of time we refer to as the intertestament period, between the end of the old covenant and the beginning of the new, a period of around 400 years. This is after Alexander died and his kingdom was divided up between his four generals. One of the generals started the Seleucid dynasty. This is one of their rulers. We think of some of the persecutions that came by the dictators for Christians by Rome. He was right up there with them. History states that it was the Jews themselves who changed his name from Epiphanes to Epimenes, which meant madman. And he was. He was a literal monster. And not just to the Jewish people, but especially to the Jewish people. He hated the Jews. He hated their religion. He hated their culture. One of the things he did was to force Hellenism, the Greek culture, upon the Jews at this period of time. He persecuted them in so many different ways. He outlawed the law of Moses. Even the old covenant, the writings, he outlawed those. If he found anybody who had the old covenant on them or in their homes, that person was executed. So he outlawed everything that they knew that was right. The law of Moses, the festivals that they had, the worship. Even if you remember desecrating the temple there in Jerusalem by sacrificing a pig on the altar. An evil man, a wicked man, again, did his best to destroy the old covenant. History will say that he died, and he died of agony, possibly for all his sins that he committed. Again, how many people will remember his name? Tiny, a fraction. And yet, God's word continues. It's still with us today. Diocletian. A lot of you historians have heard of Diocletian. One of the Roman emperors. You think about the persecutions that started for Christianity with Nero in that first century. But this is toward the end. And Diocletian was one of the last emperors who truly persecuted Christianity, maybe than the others that came before him, in all kinds of ways. And history points this out as well. He tried to exterminate Christianity completely. Again, exterminating, and he thought he did, the scriptures. He thought he had completely stamped out all of the Bibles in his own time, even had a monument erected that stated, "Extinct is the name of Christians." He boasted that the Christian religion was destroyed and that the worship of the gods had been restored, all thanks to him. He was a little premature. History states out that in less than 20 years, you had another emperor come to power, Constantine, who decreed that Christianity was no longer condemned. I remember hearing that he had offered a sizable reward to anyone when he came to the throne who could offer and show him a Bible. And in the period of, say, a day, it was around 50 that were brought to him. In a class we were studying many years ago, the instructor stated that there was someone in the audience that day when he made that proclamation. And immediately this probably brother walked toward him with his Bible. It was still there. Hadn't been destroyed. Well, Diocletian is dead, and like all these others, he knows the error of his ways. But the Bible is still with us. It truly does endure forever. It survived. What is really should boggle anybody's mind is when a religious body would go out of their way to destroy God's holy word. It makes absolutely no sense. There's really no rhyme or reason to it. Well, I don't know about the rhyme, but there definitely was a reason behind the Catholic Church in trying to exterminate Bibles from the ordinary person. And for many years, they were able to accomplish a lot of this. For example, Pope Innocent. Is that a misnomer? Oxymoron? Pope Innocent, 1199, ordered all the Bibles in France to be destroyed, to be burned. Later, there was Pope Gregory the Ninth, 1234, ordered the people to give up their Bibles. Why? So that they could also be burned. Around 10,000 were burned at one location, and this was in the 1600s. So, and we talked about this before, but so many fled Europe and came to this country so that they could worship God as they felt, as they wanted to. Because if you were in some of these other countries where the Roman Catholic Church was all powerful, they would kill you. I mentioned this before, but my own ancestors fled France in the 1600s because of that kind of persecution. People of their faith were being executed by the Catholic Church. The Jesuits boasted of burning around 60,000 Bibles in 1637. Can you imagine? 60,000. And they boasted of doing this, boasted of destroying God's word. Who are these people? Pope Clement, 1713, condemned Bible reading by Christians. But if you really think about it, it's understandable why. They did not want the Bible to be in the hands of the common person. Because you see, Catholic doctrine was not God's doctrine. It wasn't His holy word. We notice the importance of staying true to the gospel of Christ. They weren't doing that. And it was all about power for them. They didn't want to surrender that power. So they didn't want people to have Bibles in their possession at all. Because someone could read it and they could say, this is not according to Catholic doctrine. This is something completely different. Heard a story a number of years ago. It was a Catholic priest in Italy who left the Catholic Church. And he began to search for a congregation that was mentioned in the New Testament. And he searched quite a period of time. And then he finally came to the Lord's Church and was ecstatic. And proclaimed, you folks here are doing what the scriptures teach. But he left the Catholic Church because he understood they weren't doing that. They weren't following the teachings of the Word of God. So you think about how many hundreds of thousands of Bibles that were burnt, trying to destroy God's word, and yet it was still there, and it still is. But it wasn't just that. Persecution also came upon those who supported the spread of the Bible, the Word of God, so people could read it. One such individual we probably all have heard of was John Wycliffe, who lived in the 1300s. We think of Martin Luther, but there was a lot of people involved besides just Luther who were trying to change things. In many cases, reform the Catholic Church. This individual, John Wycliffe, pretty much led his life in open rebellion to the Catholic Church. So he was despised. And one of the reasons, he translated the Latin Vulgate into English. Uh-oh. That got him in trouble. After his death, the Catholics actually dug up his grave and then burned his bones and then scattered them into a nearby river, the River Swift, as it states. These individuals who did this and all these other things throughout the centuries, they all know better now. Another individual was William Tyndale. This man was strangled to death, and then his body burned at the stake. What kind of horrible crime did he commit? It must have been horrible. His crime was putting the Bible into English, the printed New Testament into English. And he's, history states he was the first one to do this. This is not written down, this was printed. But there's a number of people who are against God's holy word. A lot of atheists today are against God's holy word. I remember hearing something on the radio a number of years ago, and they were discussing why would an atheist, if I was an atheist, this guy was saying, and someone wanted to believe in God and push that agenda, I wouldn't care. Who would care? I would think that they're wrong, they're delusional, but it's a free country, they can be delusional if they want. But then he went on, maybe the reason why atheists, for the most part, hate Christianity, they hate the Bible so much, is because somewhere in the back of their mind, there's the, what if I'm wrong? What if they're right? Where will that lead? Well, they know where it's going to lead. To eternal destruction and the fires of hell. They don't want to hear it. Have you ever had a relative, maybe even a family member, who doesn't even want to hear it anymore? Because they know where they're going. Even if they refuse to believe, oh, that's just your opinion. But they had received enough teachings in their life when they were younger that a little bit of thought, maybe this is true, maybe I'm wrong. Some of you have heard of an individual named Voltaire. Semi-popular in his time. He lived from 1694 to 1778. French, infidel. History says that he proclaimed in 1778 that in 100 years, the only Bible left will be owned by collectors of antiquities, like a museum. It's only going to be in a museum. And supposedly he made the statement, it took 12 men to start Christianity and one to destroy it. Wow. He didn't think too much of himself, did he? Was he right? Do we have the Bible in front of us? I guess he was wrong. What I found interesting that around 50 years after his death, the Geneva Bible Society used his own printing press from his own house, and guess what they were printing? The Bible. A little irony, don't you think? God always has the last say and sometimes the last laugh. If you are a historian, you have heard of an individual, he was from Britain, called Thomas Paine. You remember your American Revolution. This man lived from 1737 to 1809. He wrote a small book titled Common Sense. And that was a book that helped propel the American Revolution, the colonists. And one of the points that he was making, remember he was English, that it's probably time for the colonists to throw off the yoke of the King of England and start your own country. And guess what? It worked. Talk about fuel to the fire. That's what he did. Sadly, he's also known for another book that he wrote. History states that later on, toward the end of his life, he regretted it, but it was a book called The Age of Reason, which came to be known as the Atheist Bible. He also made a prediction that the Bible would not exist in 5 years. That's what he thought. Or at least that's what he prophesied. Within 10 years, Paine had been mostly forgotten, and he died a lonely, miserable death. From what I've read, at his gravesite, there were four people. And a friend of his had to bury his body on his farm because the churches around about would not allow him to be buried there in their plot of land. Toward the end of his life, he mentioned that he wished he could have taken it all back. And by the way, his printing press was also used to produce Bibles and biblical material. Of course, he's dead now, like so many of these others. He sadly knows better. And yet the Bible endures. It's continued to be with us. One more individual. Robert Ingersoll lived from 1833 to 1899. He was an American atheist. He arrogantly proclaimed, in 15 years, I will have this book in the morgue. As one brother stated, he got part of it right. He was in the morgue, but not the Bible, not God's word. The Bible continued to endure. At the very desk where Ingersoll worked, guess what? Somebody bought it. An individual by the name of Robert Gary produced biblical material. Bible class lessons. God has the last say. God will always have the last say. His word, and this is a prophecy that's held true, endures forever. It truly does. You think of the others, individuals in our time, the modernists, for example, the textual critics that we have looked at in the past, all tried to prove that the Bible is not the inerrant, verbal, inspired word of God. It tries to go out of its way to prove all of these so-called miracles are just that. They're fables. They never did exist. They're made up. Jesus is not the Son of God. He was not born of a virgin. So they completely refuse 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, and a host of other passages that we could look at. And basically, because there is no empirical evidence, they refuse to accept it. If they pass from this life, they accept it now. They know better now. So attacked, discredited, burnt, maligned in just about every single way that you could and man could devise. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. One more piece of evidence, and a long line of evidence, that after all these hundreds, sometimes thousands of years, this book that we call the Holy Bible is still here. It endureth forever. When we think about the unique unity of it, that's even more proof. We talked about how many writers God inspired to write this over a period of a number of years, of varying backgrounds, very knowledgeable people, to kings, to keeper of sycamore trees. And yet, from beginning to end, from Genesis to Revelation, there's nothing but complete unity in the inspired word of God. All making way from the Old Testament, Jesus coming into this world. It's interesting. Everything before Acts chapter 2 speaks of the kingdom in the future. Everything after speaks of it in the present tense. And how many people, Brother Hatcher mentioned this morning, teaching about baptism, people had never heard of it. Explaining to someone years ago about Acts chapter 2 in the beginning of the church, he had never heard of that. He was also Baptist. He never heard of it because he was never taught it, which is no excuse. The Bible's here for everyone to read, for everyone to understand. People will continue to reject the Bible. There's no doubt about that. But it won't be because there's no evidence. It's because they simply refuse to obey it. Where are we this afternoon? John 12:48, Jesus states that we are going to be judged by the words in this book. Does that not behoove us to know what these words teach so that we can obey them? Are we obeying them? If you are a person of an accountable age, have you obeyed the gospel? Have you been baptized for the remission of your sins? This book will judge you. As well, it will judge every one of us. As a child of God, have we fallen away? Have we brought shame or reproach upon our Lord, the precious body of Christ? If we have, this book will judge us on that last day. If that is something that's in our lives, surely, we will repent of that before it's too late. If that is your desire, if you need the prayers of the church on your behalf for any reason, this afternoon we do pray that you will come forward. Let us all stand and let us all sing.